Good morning. What a beautiful day it is. No wind. The sun is shining. Praise the Lord. And we are here where we should be in God's presence to worship Him together. So welcome. Some announcements here that I'm going to go over first, and then Julie, you got the microphone with you? Okay. He's going to make some announcements about Vacation Bible School in just a moment. First of all, this flower here on my left, that was given by the family of Nora Eisenbrein. Her funeral was on this last week, Wednesday, at Peace Christian Reformed. And most of you know her, remember her. She lived to be 103. So what a joyous homegoing for her. Also, something not in the bulletin, someone just told me before church, there's this movie that came out, a Christian movie just before Easter, called His Only Son. Of course, obviously about Jesus, and I guess that's showing over at Armor today. I don't know if it's this afternoon or this evening. You'll have to get on their website if you're interested, but just to let you know about that. College graduates, there's a deal in the bulletin about this, but May 7th we'll be honoring our graduates, so the college ones are that's harder to keep track of, so if you have one, let us know this week, please. Also, Christian Ed Committee, we're meeting after church in the adult classroom. Ladies, just a reminder about Salad Supper this coming Wednesday night at 6:30. Lori Whale's going to be sharing, one of our own, sharing her testimony and her life and how God has worked in many ways. Our principal, Mrs. Mutter, is going to be singing a couple songs, I believe. So thanks for doing that, Nadia. So, we need you to sign up if you're coming. That sheet is out in the narthex at 6:30 Wednesday night. Bring a salad and enough to share for everyone else and the men who are doing the dishes behind the scenes. Let's see. The rest I will let you read as you have time. I think that's all I needed to say. So, Julie, if you want to stand up there.
Good morning. I am just here to encourage you all to consider coming to Bible school. Every single one of you in this room, young and old, please join us. Please consider joining us. We are changing it up a little bit this year to help encourage people to come May 29th through June 2nd. There will be supper every single night from 5:45 to 6:30. Our encouragement is that we get young and old to sit at the table and carry on a conversation. Look at each other, smile, fellowship, enjoy yourself. And then after supper, we'll go into our opening session at 6:30. If you don't want to be a true volunteer in the classroom, but you still wouldn't mind listening to what the lesson is, I'm pretty sure Pastor Mike's time is first, so you're welcome to just mosey right back there and enjoy Pastor Mike's lesson time with the fourth and fifth graders. So just consider it a time that you can come together with our youth. We have to train them up. As a church, we need to come together as a church and do our part, so please consider helping us. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie, our director. Thank you for all the time you put into it. There are sign-up sheets still in the social hall for food items that are needed that week. Okay? All right, let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, what a glorious day this is, as your word says. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. So we do, and we are glad. We are glad to be here, Father, with you. There's no other place we would rather be. As we've just sung about your majesty and your greatness and your power. You are Lord of all creation. You are Lord of the heavens and the earth. And you are our Father. And Jesus, you are the good shepherd. You are our shepherd. How incredible that is. So thank you for all that have gathered in here. You know every one of us by name. You know our joys, our sorrows, our struggles. And we ask for you to move among us by the power of your Spirit. Touch each of our lives. Fill us with your Spirit afresh today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 210. In the hymnal, if we stand together, the words will also be on the screen, whichever you prefer. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. the Lord. What a beautiful hymn. Take a moment, greet those around you, please, before you sing. Okay, we will have our sharing of joys and concerns, certainly a joy. We have our 1, 2, 3, 4th pew up here. There's a Bend reunion this afternoon at Grace Lutheran Church Fellowship Hall. So we have three of Arnold and Ruth Bender's children here. Garth, right? Dalen. And his wife, Carolyn. Of course, Sandy Bender's with us. And Margaret, and her husband, Irvin. Good to have you all. Yes, many of us, myself included, have great memories of Arnold and Ruth Bender from when I was in high school. Of course, now they are in heaven. Amen. So glad to have you all. It's a joy. Some other things. And I told a couple of people if I'm a little off this morning, it's because I did the midnight mass at the prom last night. At midnight. Just far beyond my bedtime. So, but we're here. I'm glad we get to do it. Anyway, a couple other things here. First, I want to mention we're Gary and Sally Seiler with us. Glad to have you guys. And Gary, you know, he fell on the ice, I don't know what it's been, a couple months back for sure. Broke his femur, in the process of that, they actually found a tumor there in the femur, and so on that, this Thursday, he's scheduled to have surgery there. I won't go into all the details of that, but we are sure praying for both of you during that time. Also, Kathy Nuss, this would be Jerome's wife. And this went on the prayer chain, too. She was diagnosed at the end of March with multiple myeloma. So I won't go into all those details, but a tumor found on the front of her skull and that is inoperable, I believe, the way I understand it. So they're hoping on Wednesday, to start radiation treatments there. Continued prayers for this young man from Viber, Colby Sherman, which would be a great nephew of Amy Nuss. He's just 17. Years old, has osteosarcoma, lots of these cancers. He had chemo this last Thursday, maybe is still in the hospital over the weekend, but then we'll have a treatment for the next, well, that and 2 more weeks, I think, and then a couple weeks off. And so, serious situation there. Also, Caleb Pedersen, another young man, has a lot going on. I had heard they were able to have his wedding yesterday, so we praise the Lord for that. Still need lots of prayers there. Let me see. Okay, Jim Massey is in the hospital up at Sioux Falls, has quite a lengthy stay ahead of him, so prayers there as well. Anything else on this side? Steve. Yes, amen. Yeah, we have to be specific, right? Prayers for warm weather, not hot. 90 degrees like we had a week and a half ago. And thank the Lord for the rain this week, safety during the planting season. Yeah, how about over here? Yes, Savannah. Lillian's birthday was this last Tuesday, and she is 5, and Ryan's birthday is coming up on Wednesday. Happy birthday, Ryan, and Lillian both. Okay? All right, let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time. Joys of having some guests here for the Bender reunion, and how how exciting that is when family from near and far can come and gather and share memories. Memories of their childhood, memories of, I'm sure all these three were confirmed in Salem Reformed and have many memories of growing up in the life of this local church. We ask that you bless their day and their traveling back home, wherever that might be. We do thank you, Lord, for birthdays that were shared today or in this past week and this coming week. Bless them. Watch over them. We thank you for the joys of weddings of Caleb Pedersen yesterday, and also Elton and Myrna Herbold's granddaughter Megan, her wedding yesterday. Exciting times, for sure, as two are joined together as one. We lift up these, Lord, in need of your healing touch. Gary and Sally, as they're here with us this morning, as he's got this surgery scheduled for Thursday, we come to you first, Jesus, as our great physician. Thank you for going before them. Thank you for working your power throughout his body, even now, before the surgery happens. But we ask that you take hold of the surgeon's hands and guide him or her and all that are helping through that procedure. We pray the same for Jerome and Kathy Nuss. These things we never want to hear or find out, but so it is. So we pray for Kathy and all that lies before her. Father, we know this is not a surprise to you, even though it was to us and to them. But we ask that you hold her close in your everlasting arms as your power again works mightily through her body and these others with cancer, that you would drive that from them. And thank you for the work you do through medical science, the doctors and the nurses and all the healthcare professionals that work so hard and diligently for our needs. Bless them, we pray. For these young men, Colby Sherman, Lord, in a very similar difficult situation, give him strength and his family for that journey that lies ahead in healing. Jim Massey, we pray. Ken Winterstein, and many, many names in our bulletin, Lord, that we lift up daily. Thank you for any other needs that maybe were not mentioned, or joys. For the rain, Lord, thank you for the rain showers. Thank you for the warmer temperatures coming. Father, as this is the season to plant, and you know what is necessary for that to happen. You know the moisture needed for the crops to grow and the trees and all of your creation. So we dedicate this entire season to you and trust you for your provision through it all, for your safety over all our rural areas. This is a vibrant part of who we are. Thank you for going before us. For our nation, Lord, we thank you for this nation. We ask for healing throughout our land. We ask for the outpouring of your Spirit upon us, from the East Coast to the West and everywhere in between, that hearts would be turned towards you, Father. Thank you for our troops that serve so faithfully. As Lee Heckenlagel is back after 2 weeks abroad in the Guards, and many in our congregation that serve full-time, many that serve in the Guards, bless them all. Keep them safe. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Psalm 34, verses 8 through 10 says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing. The lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing." Let's stand together, please. We'll sing the next song.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise
praise you with our lives as we serve you each and every day. We praise you with our giving. So we put the money not just in a box in the back, but Lord, just as this is the season for planting naturally, so we sow into your kingdom. Thanking you for all of your provision in our lives. Thanking you for your word and your spirit so mightily at work within this local church and far beyond as we proclaim the message of Jesus Christ, that you are Lord of all. Thank you for these blessings. In Jesus' name. Father, we confess our faith together before you through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the one holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The children want to come, please, for the Kingdom Kids time.
Here we are. Thank you for waiting. Oh my goodness. How is everyone today? Good. Well, today we're going to play a little game, and it's an old game. A game that was even on a TV show before I was even born. That game is called Who Do You Trust? Anybody remember that game show? It was only on for like a year when I researched it. Okay. Well, come on up, you can sit down. We're gonna do my version of this. That's a cute baby. So I would like the fourth graders to come up here and help me. If there's any fourth graders here. Okay, Sydney, Ava. Oh, you two are good. You're gonna be my helpers here. So how this game works, oh, maybe you should go over here, so I'll talk to you both like this. So I'm gonna ask a question, and then I'm gonna say to you, each one, who do you trust? And you have to pick someone to answer the question, okay? And then I'll ask you a question, and I'm going to say, who do you trust? And you're going to ask somebody. Got it? Okay, here's my first question. What person in the Bible was swallowed by a big fish? Ava, who do you pick? Who do you trust to answer that correctly? What? Valerie. Jonah, good job. That you're smart. That's very good. Okay. Cindy, here's your question. Who built the ark? Who do you trust? Hadley. Who built the ark? Helper McKinley. Helper. Tell him. Who built the ark? Noah built the ark, right? You were just a little... star. You were just stage fright. Okay? Right. Noah built the ark. Okay? Now I'm going to ask one question about a TV show. Now, this was when Nathan was little, this is what he watched a lot. Okay? So we're back to Ava. Who lives in a green, who is green and lives in a trash can on Sesame Street? What's his name? Ava, who do you trust? I don't know if you're going to know it. You better? Raylan. Oscar the Grouch. Oscar the Grouch. Yeah, good job. Okay, one more, and this has to do with what we're going to be talking about today in church. Okay? Who killed a giant, a big tall guy with a sling and a stone? Who do you trust to give that answer? Who had his rock and his stone and he went like this and he hit the tall guy right in the forehead?
Savannah.
What? Okay. Ask somebody else. Hadley. David. Yes, very good. Very good. Let's give him a hand clap. Okay, good job. You can sit down. You know, it's fun to play that game, but in real life, that's a question that we have to answer. Who do you trust? Now, as we just talked about, David was the guy that loved God. He was the teenager that took care of the sheep, and he loved God with all of his heart. And if we would ask him, if he was here and we asked him, David, who did you trust? What do you think he would have said? Psalms 90:23, verse 1. Jesus, right. The Lord, he said, is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. So God, he trusted in God. And as we know, he took care of the sheep. He had to make sure they were fed. He had to make sure they were protected, that they got water, that they didn't have a bunch of bugs bothering them. He took care of them. They did not have to worry because David was their shepherd. So you and I, boys and girls, who are we going to trust when we have some hard times that come in our life? When you have some sad times? Jesus. We're going to trust Jesus and God. God is our shepherd. All the time, every day, no matter what we face, we can know God is our shepherd. He will take care of us. He will get us through anything. So we can have peace in our hearts because let's make it personal. God is my shepherd, and I shall not want. Okay, let's say that together. Ready, everybody? God is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He'll take care of us. And in the Passion Bible, this is how it says that. The Lord is my best friend and my shepherd. I always have more than enough to pass on. That's from a different translation. Jesus, God, we love them. They're our shepherd, our best friend, okay? All right, let's pray. Close our eyes, fold our hands. Lord, we thank you so much, God, that you are our shepherd. We thank you that you watch over us and take care of us. No matter how little or how old we are, we can always come to you. Thank you for Jesus also and the Holy Spirit. I ask you to bless these boys and girls wherever they go this week. Help them to share about you to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you can get your papers.
Thank you, Ann. Let's sing number 690. He leadeth me. So children are going back to their seats.
Thank you.
bow our heads, please, once more. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word and your spirit. That you lead us and guide us. Jesus, you are good shepherd. Every step of the way, help us to be your faithful follower. Help us to listen closely to your word as we look into it this morning, as we study it in our homes every day of the week, that we would be doers of your word and not just hearers. Let our minds be set upon you this morning, we pray. And Father, I ask that you would speak through me by your Spirit to those gathered here. In Jesus' name, amen. So, Psalm 23, we all know it well. There's times, I get certainly plenty of requests of, could you do a sermon on this or that or the other, and I always say, well, I'll pray about it. So, this one, I've had different ones. I did a series on this actually 10 years ago. I looked. So, if you were here 10 years ago, please don't think, really? We can always learn. Some of the younger ones that were here 10 years ago were just in school age, maybe not paying that much attention. A lot of you were not here, part of the congregation 10 years ago. I'm sure this is one you've heard many sermons on. We're actually just going to be on the first verse today. That's how we're going to work through this. There is so much in this beautiful psalm. It's a favorite of many. And this is from the King James Version. Once I'm ready, we're going to say this together. This is one of the passages that the confirmation kids learn in King James English, because I believe it's important for them to know some King James English, as many of us learned it all that way. And to me, I just don't think there's any other translation that compares to this. The meaning of it and how it flows is beautiful. So join me, please, in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Beautiful, isn't it? Now, many of you have that memorized. Maybe several of you don't. I pray that as we go through this, that you will get that settled deep in your heart and in your mind. I have seen over our years here, our many years here, I can think of several times of people in the later years of their lives where maybe dementia or a form of Alzheimer's has set in, and they might not recognize their own children. They might not recognize their spouse. They might not be able to hardly speak a word in a sentence. But I can tell you many times where I sit with them and say, let's say the 23rd Psalm, and they will say it perfectly. I've seen it with stroke victims, been in the hospital where no words are coming to form, and I'll say, let's say the 23rd Psalm, and they will speak it perfectly to the astonishment of the nurses who might be in the room. So God's word is powerful, we know that. And Psalm 119, verse 11, that's why the psalmist said there, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against you. How do we hide his word in our heart? Number one, by memorizing it. Secondly, meditating on it, which that's how we're going to go through. This is how we meditate on God's word, is just piece by piece. So will you take this first verse this week, and I hope you'll think a lot about what I'm going to bring out this morning. Anne brought it out in the, what was the translation? The Passion Translation. Okay, that was neat. I'm going to read the first verse in the Amplified. It says there, "The Lord is my shepherd, to feed, to guide, and to shield me. I shall not want." So the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Now, when I was growing up as a child and learning this, and I knew it well and still do, but in my mind, probably even into middle school, you know, you're just learning at that point, and I would say it, and how the sentence went in my mind, I took it as, "The Lord is my shepherd, I don't want him, you know, I shall not want." That's how it registered in my head. Well, I knew that wasn't right, but it took me a while in my mind to get, the Lord's my shepherd, I don't have any wants, right? So then the light bulb came on. The Lord. In Hebrew, there, Jehovah, Yahweh, would be another translation. That name of God, that's why as you read your Old Testament Bibles, why that is all four letters capitalized, L-O-R-D. It is God's name, so holy, that it, and we talked about this in the Lenten season, one of those services, that even as the scribes were recording the scriptures and making copies of them, whenever they came to this name, God's name, Jehovah, Yahweh, they would stop, they would wash themselves with the ritual cleansing, they would pick up that ink pen, how they had it, they would write his name, they would stop, they would do a ritual washing, and go on with the rest of the verse. Think of that. Do you know how many times we see Lord, capital L-O-R-D, in the Old Testament? There is reason for that. On occasion, you will find Lord, capital L, small O-R-D. Just a different name of God in Hebrew. But this, God's most holy name. So in the Old Testament, of course, David said, "The Lord is my shepherd." We come into the New Testament, John chapter 10, and Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd." And he is for us today. What, this is part of your meditation in your bulletin. John 10 verse 11, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep." Who owns the sheep? Jesus owns us. As we can yield our lives to him. He is your owner. He is. We got to realize that. Got the hired hand, you got the owner. Well, there is a big difference. The hired hand, it says, when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. Then he says it again, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep know me." We have some shepherds in the congregation. Jai, Melanie, Ryan, and Jesse, Garing, Friesens. We have sheep, maybe some others. I don't mean to miss you. Those were the three that came to mind. So you know a lot about this and what it takes. But truly amazing that we can, as Anne had the kids, change that around. And as we should, Jesus, I thank you that you are my shepherd. You are my good shepherd. Thank you for watching over me. You make it personal that way with him. That relationship that he has with each one of us is our shepherd. That he cares about every detail of our lives in ways without us even knowing fully what's happening. As I had a call from Jerome Nuss this week, and just filling me in about Kathy, telling me that I could put this on the prayer chain. He was going through this series of events, just day by day. I'm not going to give all the days. And I was jotting it down because it really is amazing. God's timing from March 28th When the first incident happened with Kathy and there was double vision as she was driving, all of a sudden, just like that, well, you know, that's not good. So she turns around, gets into Vance Thompson. Well, everything looks fine with your eyes. You need a neurologist. Well, if any of you have tried to get into the neurologist for the moment, that is very difficult in Sioux Falls. Can be a month or more down the road for an appointment. Let's see. 2-3 days later, they got in. Neurologist. Then an MRI was scheduled for a week and a half later. That was in the time in early March, one of the snowstorms that came through the middle part of our state. Someone canceled, hey, you want that MRI now? Yeah. Saw, got the results a couple days later. That can take a full week often, MRI, right? You got this tumor on the front of your skull, not in your brain, but up here. That's that multiple myeloma. CT scan, just a day or two later. Oncologist, just a couple days later. All of this just falling into place. What normally would take many, many weeks for all this to happen. The radiologist, just 2 days later, and then their first appointment coming this Wednesday. And they are clearly seeing God's hand in all of this. Just reminds me of what we're talking about. The Lord is my shepherd. What the Amplified says, to feed, to guide, to shield me. And so he is. So we find comfort and confidence in this, in knowing this and being reminded of it. Comfort. We had confirmation Sunday last week. 8 of our 8th graders. I'm sure you all have memories of your confirmation day with Odenbach, Kempkin. Yeah, okay. What is your only comfort? Your only comfort in life and in death. And I'm not going to read the whole answer. What's the first part? That I am not my own. What was Jesus saying back up there in John 10, verse 11? I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. Catechism. What's your comfort? That I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior Jesus Christ. And on that goes in such a beautiful way. So David, as God used him to write this, inspired him by the Holy Spirit, knew firsthand because he was a shepherd. He was the youngest of all the brothers, if you remember, and he was the one that was out herding sheep. And when he was out there doing that, he just worshiped the Lord. Out there, the beauty of God's creation, just worshiping the Lord. And God, he was musically gifted. God would give him these psalms. He'd record them down. He'd sing them. He would share them. And we have them today, 3,000 years later, to enjoy for ourselves. He knew that the livelihood of those sheep, his father's sheep, we should say, depended on what kind of shepherd he was going to be. And there are different kinds. Some men, as he was, would have been gentle, kind, caring with the sheep, brave. Was he brave with those sheep? You know he was, and brought Goliath in with one of the questions, David and Goliath. And what did David say when he went to King Saul and said, I'll go fight that giant? And Saul's like, you can't do that. You are just a kid. This guy's a giant. He's fought for all of his years. No. And David, this is in 1 Samuel 17. What did he say? He said, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, and I rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its beard, by its hair, some translations say beard, struck it and killed it. He's like, And he goes on, if you remember in 1 Samuel, who is this uncircumcised Philistine who has defied the armies of the living God? I love that verse. So David knew. Others, the hired hands, nothing wrong with hired hands, but some of them were not good shepherds and they didn't care about the sheep. So it depended. As I listened to all your stories, many of you who have the livestock, every year when it comes to calving, and you'll tell me different things, and I am absolutely amazed at the care that goes into all of that. That whole calving process, the hours, 24/7, watching over them, having to tube them at times, having to bottle feed, having to bring them inside even to warm them up, having to, even if there's maybe twins or a calf dies, and then you skin the hide off that and put it on another calf, so that mom of the one that died will take the milk from the mother, and the mom will accept that calf. Those things are incredible. They are truly incredible. And so all the more, Jesus, our good shepherd, watches over us. I have some books I've read on this. There was one, it's called A Shepherd Looks at the 23rd Psalm. I want to read one of his quotes. He said, "Sheep do not just take care of themselves, as some might suppose. They require, more than any other class of livestock, endless attention and meticulous care." Now, those that have sheep could probably give an amen to that statement, I'm assuming. So, the Bible calls us sheep more than once. Hate to say. We can act like that. But it's no accident, we're in letter B if you're doing your outline, maybe it's hard to follow. It's no accident that God has chosen to call us sheep. It is not by accident. Sometimes our behavior as people and sheep can be pretty similar. I always remember Clara Bittner, lived to be 99. I looked up, she went home to heaven in 2016, May 8th, coming up at the age of 99. And in my visits with her, there were times I talked to her about her childhood, and they had sheep for a time. And she said, "But then my dad got rid of them." I said, "Why did he get rid of them?" "You know, they were always exactly in the wrong place. They were always exactly where they were not supposed to be. And finally, my dad just got tired of it." Thankfully, Jesus doesn't get tired of us. When we are in the wrong places, where we're not supposed to be, doing what we shouldn't be doing, he is patient with us. Psalm 95, part of that you probably know well. "Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand." So you are sheep, I'm a sheep, he's the good shepherd. Psalm 79:13, another verse. "So we, your people, Lord, and sheep of your pasture, will give you thanks forever. We will show forth your praise to all generations. The Lord is my shepherd." So we care. We care for our livestock. We care for our pets. I have to tell you a quick Cameron story. Cameron, Arizona. It's been a long time since I've said this. But as we care for our pets. So out there where we lived, the dogs did not fare very well normally. They just ran in the running packs. And so as we lived there, there was this dog named Barney, who was a purebred. Did I write that down? I think he was like a Brittany Spaniel. Anyway, would have been a very nice looking dog, but the owners there didn't live far from us, maybe 50 yards, and they did not take care of that dog by feeding or anything. And he'd run and he'd come over and started feeding him, which was okay. The hard part of it was the other dogs would beat Barney up. And, you know, if a dog's getting beaten up, you know, that you know, I'm not going to imitate her, but that's not fun to hear. And that I didn't like it. My wife really did not like it. And finally, one day, she said to me, "That's it. Tomorrow, I want," she was still, well, you were working up to the city in the boarding school, right? "So I want you to take Barney down to Flagstaff, hour away, to the Humane Society. Maybe somebody will adopt him." Okay, that was my assignment. So I got him in the pickup, go down to the post office there, the trading post. On my way, gonna get the mail and go. Well, lo and behold, one of our church members, I won't say his name, because since we're on YouTube now, was working there, and he comes over, "Hey, Pastor Mike, what are you doing?" "Well, this dog, da-da-da, as I've just told you, I'm taking him to Yankton to the Humane Society." "Well, you don't have to go all the way to Flagstaff. We'll take him." They lived a couple miles away, and they always had lots of dogs that they did not take care of or feed very well. And I knew that, but I thought, okay, I didn't have to drive an hour to Flagstaff with this dog. Okay. So, mission accomplished, I thought, until Ann gets home from work. "Well, did you take Barney to Flagstaff?" "No." "What'd you do with him?" "I gave him to so-and-so." "You what?" This was one of our arguments early on. "You what? You know they don't take care of their dogs. I cannot believe you did that. Oh, no, 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 no." Who is in the doghouse now? Me. Okay. I didn't say too much more because I didn't want to say the wrong thing after I'd done the wrong thing. All right, going over to so-and-so's. "Get Barney. I'm sorry. I've got to take Barney to the Humane Society. Sorry." "Okay." So off I go to rescue myself and the dog. Anyway, we care for our pets. We do. We really do. Secondly here, "I shall not want," it goes on, the verse, "I shall not want." As I said, Clara Bittner, she said, "Those sheep are always exactly where they are not supposed to be. Sheep can often want what they don't have." Cattle too, right? What's the phrase we use? "The grass is always on the other side of the fence." Yes, and they get out. So contentment versus greed. Their contentment, we choose to be satisfied with the grass on our side of the fence. What God has given us. Greed is the opposite, wanting more than what our shepherd, our good shepherd, is providing. That's, we go all the way back to Adam and Eve in the garden. They had everything they could ever want. There was only one boundary, one thing in that entire garden that God said, "Do not eat of the fruit of that tree of the knowledge of good and evil." You know that. We know it well. Genesis 2, the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree, anything." And think of the variety that would have been there. "Any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die." And you know all in that. In dying, you're going to die spiritually, and then you're going to die physically. That's, I'm not doing that sermon now. They were content until who came along? Satan, right? With his deception, he comes slithering in the form of that serpent. He says to the woman, "Woman, did God really say?" And that's exactly what he still does today with the word. So much. "Did God really say, oh, that's not for today. He didn't mean that for now. You know, times have changed so much." No, no, that is what he said, and that is what he means. "Did God really say," and here's how he twists it, "did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" Twists God's word right there. She answers, well, she answers him back, "No, this is what God said." Verse 4, And Satan answers back, "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. You will be like God, knowing good and evil." In other words, being a God yourself. Well, we know the story, right? They fell. And so still today, that's what Satan does. Tries to sow seeds of discontentment in our lives in so many ways. We have to learn to trust the Good Shepherd, to be content with what he provides. I'm not saying that doesn't mean we don't expand our operations on the farm or in our business or whatever. I'm not saying that at all. But to get into greed, that's a different thing. So, trying to finish this up here, the Apostle Paul, he had to learn what it means to be content. He said in Philippians 4, he had to learn that secret. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. And then he goes on. Young Timothy, he had to learn the secret. You know, it's amazing what sheep, let's talk about natural sheep, can actually live on. I'd say here, they got it pretty good, even in a drought year. But some who've been to Israel, there are lots of sheep in Israel, you wonder what they eat. Where we were with the Navajos, terrain is very similar on the western side where we lived, of the reservation, as in Israel. Very little to eat of anything. That's why the shepherd has to take him out. And two different times, I got to go with some of the high school boys when they were out herding sheep for their parents. This was before Ann was there. And both times, they herd the sheep from behind. And it was a long day, just going, covering a lot of ground, because you just have little bits of shrub, sage, and things like that, hardly any grass at all. And if they'd start getting off over here, you know, there's rocks all over, and pick one up and throw it over there, you know, they'd get back. Or they'd holler at them, whatever. It's sheep, just like the Bible says. Jesus said, "My sheep know my voice." Guess what? Those sheep knew their voice. If I tried hollering, yeah, I didn't do anything. No, it had to be those guys that they were used to. So Timothy had to learn this too. 1 Timothy, you can look that verse up later. It's in your insert. Paul said to Timothy, but godliness with contentment is great gain. So we should be satisfied with Jesus as our good shepherd as we walk with him. What more could we want, really? Two times in John 10, Jesus, yes, he said, "I am the good shepherd." And two times he said, "I lay down my life for the sheep." He did at the cross. He does, seated at the right hand of the Father. He prays for us. The Bible says he ever lives to make intercession for you. Let's say verse 1 together, please. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Amen. So, just be pondering this, the 23rd Psalm. We won't go straight through because there'll be Sundays I'll have to take breaks for a different direction. But we'll be going on this direction. And just talk to him in that way. Jesus, thank you. You are my shepherd, my good shepherd. I need you to lead me. I don't know what to do in this situation. I need your guidance. Or I need your protection through this time of my life, whatever it might be. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are your sheep. Yes, we truly are. And Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. Lord, forgive us for that. Forgive us of our sin. But thank you for always taking us back. You're always there. As the verse goes on, and Father, it says, you have laid on him the iniquity of us all. Thank you for doing that at the cross. Thank you for saving us, for guiding us and leading us. We love you with all of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. A closing hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." As Paul said, I've learned the secret of being content. So I say this probably every time we sing this hymn, but I feel I need to. But as we know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, yes, we can sing this hymn, "It Is Well With Our Soul." If we don't know Jesus, it is not well. We are in big trouble without him. So let's stand and sing it out, turn up the organ a little. Okay, "It Is Well With My Soul." Congregation, Lord, there are some difficult situations. physically, and I'm sure beyond that. But you are in control, and you teach us to say, as we have sung, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. So we praise you by faith for the work you are doing in each of these lives, even right here this morning, by the power of your Spirit, in Jesus' name. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. And we today, as a prayer for our nation, are just going to sing God Bless America in closing. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day. Thank you, Cindy, for the beautiful music.